Simon & Schuster Audio presents Daddy's Little Girl by Mary Higgins Clark. Read by Jan Maxwell.
Part 1. When Ellie awoke that morning, it was with the sense that something terrible had happened. Instinctively, she reached for Bones, the soft and cuddly stuffed dog who had shared her pillow ever since she could remember. When she'd had her 7th birthday last month, Andrea, her 15-year-old sister, had teased her that it was time to toss Bones in the attic. Then Ellie remembered what was wrong. Andrea hadn't come home last night. After dinner, she had gone to her best friend Joan's house to study for a math test. She had promised to be home by 9 o'clock. At 9:15, Mommy went to Joan's house to walk Andrea home, but they said Andrea had left at 8 o'clock. Mommy had come back home worried and almost crying, just as Daddy got in from work. Daddy was a lieutenant in the New York State Police. Right away, he and Mommy had started calling all of Andrea's friends, but no one had seen her. Then Daddy said he was going to drive around to the bowling alley and to the ice cream parlor, just in case Andrea had gone there. "If she lied about doing homework until 9 o'clock, she won't set foot out of this house for 6 months," he'd said angrily. And then he'd turn to Mommy. "If I said it once, I've said it 1,000 times. I don't want her to go out after dark alone." Despite his raised voice, Ellie could tell that Daddy was more worried than angry. "For heaven's sake, Ted, she went out at 7 o'clock. She got to Jones. She was planning to be home by 9, and I even walked over there to meet her." "Then where is she?" They made Ellie go to bed, and eventually she fell asleep, waking only now. Maybe Andrea was home by now, she thought hopefully. She slipped out of bed, rushed across the room, and darted down the hall to Andrea's room. "Be there," she begged. "Please be there." She opened the door. Andrea's bed had not been slept in. Her bare feet silent on the steps, Ellie hurried downstairs. Their neighbor, Mrs. Hilmer, was sitting with Mommy in the kitchen. Mommy was wearing the same clothes she had on last night, and she looked as if she'd been crying for a long time. Ellie ran to her. "Mommy." Mommy hugged her and began to sob. Ellie felt Mommy's hand clutching her shoulder, so hard that she was almost hurting her. "Mommy, where's Andrea?"
"We don't know. Daddy and the police are looking for her."
"Ellie, why don't you get dressed and I'll fix you some breakfast?" Mrs. Hilmer asked. No one was saying that she should hurry up because the school bus would be coming pretty soon. Without asking, Ellie knew she wouldn't be going to school today. She dutifully washed her face and hands and brushed her teeth and hair, and then put on play clothes, a turtleneck shirt and her favorite blue slacks, and went downstairs again. Just as she sat at the table where Mrs. Hilmer had put out juice and cornflakes, Daddy came through the kitchen door.
"No sign of her," he said. "We've looked everywhere. There was a guy collecting for some phony charity, ringing doorbells in town yesterday. He was in the diner last night and left around 8 o'clock. He would have passed Joan's house on the way to the highway around the time Andrea left. They're looking for him."
Ellie could tell that Daddy was almost crying. He also hadn't seemed to notice her, but she didn't mind. Sometimes when Daddy came home, he was upset because something sad had happened while he was at work, and for a while he'd be very quiet. He had that same look on his face now. Andrea was hiding. Ellie was sure of it. She had probably left Joan's house early on purpose because she was meeting Rob Westerfield in the hideout. Then maybe it got late and she was afraid to come home. Daddy had said that if she ever lied again about where she'd been, he'd make her quit the school band. He'd said that when he found out she had gone for a ride with Rob Westerfield in his car when she was supposed to be at the library. Andrea loved being in the band. Last year, she'd been the only freshman chosen for the flute section. But if she'd left Joan's house early and gone to the hideout to meet Rob, and Daddy found out, that would mean she'd have to give it up. Mommy always said that Andrea could twist Daddy around her little finger, but she didn't say that last month when one of the state troopers told Daddy he'd stopped Rob Westerfield to give him a ticket for speeding and that Andrea was with him at the time. Daddy hadn't said anything about it until after dinner.
Then he asked Andrea how long she'd been at the library. She didn't answer him. Then he said, I see you're smart enough to realize that the trooper who gave Westerfield the ticket would tell me you were with him. Andrea, that guy is not only rich and spoiled, he's a bad apple through and through. When he kills himself speeding, you're not going to be in the car. You are absolutely forbidden to have anything to do with him. The hideout was in the garage behind the great big house that old Mrs. Westerfield, Rob's grandmother, lived in all summer. It was always unlocked, and sometimes Andrea and her friends sneaked in there and smoked cigarettes. Andrea had taken Ellie there a couple of times when she was babysitting her. Her friends had been really mad at Andrea for bringing her along, but she had said, Ellie's a good kid. She's not a snitch. Hearing that had made Ellie feel great, but Andrea hadn't let Ellie have even one puff of the cigarette. Ellie was sure that last night Andrea had left Joan's house early because she was planning to meet Rob Westerfield. Ellie had heard her when she talked to him on the phone yesterday, and when she was finished, she was practically crying. I told Rob I was going to the mixer with Polly, she said, and now he's really mad at me. Ellie thought about the conversation as she finished the cornflakes and juice. Daddy was standing at the stove. He was holding a cup of coffee. Mommy was crying again, but making almost no sound. Then, for the first time, Daddy seemed to notice her. Ellie, I think you'd be better off in school. At lunchtime, I'll take you over.
Is it all right if I go outside now?
Yes, but stay around the house. Ellie ran for her jacket and was quickly out the door. It was the 15th of November, and the leaves were damp and felt sloshy underfoot. The sky was heavy with clouds, and she could tell it was going to rain again. Ellie wished they were back in Irvington where they used to live. It was lonesome here. Mrs. Hilmer's house was the only other one on this road. Daddy had liked living in Irvington, but they'd moved here, five towns away, because Mommy wanted a bigger house and more property. They found they could afford that if they moved farther up in Westchester, to a town that hadn't yet become a suburb of New York City. When Daddy said he missed Irvington, where he'd grown up and where they'd lived until 2 years ago, Mommy would tell him how great the new house was. Then he'd say that in Irvington we had a million-dollar view of the Hudson River and the Tappan Zee Bridge, and he didn't have to drive 5 miles for a newspaper or a loaf of bread. There were woods all around their property. The big Westerfield house was directly behind theirs, but on the other side of the woods. Glancing back at the kitchen window to make sure no one had seen her, Ellie began to dart through the trees. 5 minutes later, she reached the clearing and ran across the field to where the Westerfield property began. Feeling more and more alone, she raced up the long driveway and darted around the mansion, a small figure lost in the lengthening shadows of the approaching storm. There was a side door to the garage, and that was the one that was unlocked. Even so, it was hard for Ellie to turn the handle. Finally, she succeeded and stepped into the gloom of the interior. The garage was big enough to hold 4 cars, but the only one Mrs. Westerfield left after the summer was the van. Andrea and her friends had brought some old blankets to sit on when they went there. They always sat in the same spot, at the back of the garage behind the van, so that if anyone happened to look in the window, they wouldn't be able to see them. Ellie knew that was where Andrea would be hiding if she was here. She didn't know why she felt suddenly afraid, but she did. Now, instead of running, she had to practically drag her feet to make them move toward the back of the garage. But then she saw it, the edge of the blanket peeking out from behind the van. Andrea was here. She and her friends would never have left the blankets out. When they left, they always folded them and hid them in the cabinet with the cleaning supplies. Andrea. Now she ran, calling softly so that Andrea wouldn't be scared. She was probably asleep, Ellie decided. Yes, she was. Even though the garage was filled with shadows, Ellie could see Andrea's long hair trailing out from under the blankets. Andrea, it's me. Ellie sank to her knees beside Andrea and pulled back the blanket covering her face. Andrea had a mask on, a terrible monster mask that looked all sticky and gummy. Ellie reached down to pull it off, and her fingers went into a broken space in Andrea's forehead. As she jerked back, she became aware.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.